Hey, by the way, when we were like running out, did you see that alien Tony Hawk game?
Yeah, I did see that actually. Yeah. It looked pretty fun.
You don't think I'd be able to like get that on Earth anywhere, do you? Like buy that somewhere?
The alien game?
Yeah, torrented. Like, yeah, the alien game.
I think it'd be pretty hard. Only because it is an alien game. I don't think so.
Yeah, I was just wondering. It's stupid to even ask.
No, I think we're approaching Earth.
Cool. I've always wanted to see it from space. Wait, what? What am I looking at? What is that?
Charlie, that's not Earth, right?
Dude, that's completely flat. That's 100% flat,
I
know,
that's
dude.
What I mean. That's what I'm saying. That can't be real, right? That's not.
We're looking at it, dude. The Earth is flat. The Earth is flat.
Earth can't actually be flat, right?
There's the glass dome, too, dude. Oh my God, dude.
This can't be real.
I need to sit down.
This can't.
Pim, we need to take this to the grave. We cannot tell anybody. This changes literally this changes everything.
I know. We can never tell.
I might actually puke. Get back a little. I'm gonna puke. Stay back.
Oh my!
I'm gonna throw up.
Okay.
I'm gonna throw up.
The Earth is flat, Charlie.
I know.
So why is that video really, really scary? Why does it give you a pit in your stomach? And what do we call that? Like, what do we call that when something is scary in a way that you cannot understand it, and it's not scary in a way that you're running away from something like traditional horror? This is called cosmic horror, and I've been really interested lately in figuring out the ways that cosmic horror align with philosophy, because philosophy is essentially cosmic horror, because it is concepts that we cannot really describe, and it makes our brains like we literally just can't even think about them. So I found this philosophy iceberg from this person on TikTok. I'm gonna put the username here very, very large because they deserve lots of credit. This is like a beast of an iceberg, and there are concepts on here that I've never heard of and that were really, really interesting to research. This is probably going to be like 3 or 4 parts. This is going to be part 1, and I'm going to tackle the first 4-ish levels of the iceberg, because let's be fucking honest, like the first beginning of it is not as interesting as like the bottom half, and like I really want to get into the meat of the bottom half. The purpose of this is I really want to understand why cosmic horror is scarier to me than like a hacksaw murderer, and why I'm so interested in the concepts of cosmic horror, and what other media can scare me in the way that this like 1 minute clip really effectively does. And basically this iceberg goes from like basically intro to philosophy down into the very bottom. It goes into concepts that I genuinely had a pit in my stomach when I was researching. And so I understand if a lot of people don't want to watch these beginning parts and they want to wait until I cover the bottom half, that's totally fine. But I did find some really kind of freaky concepts in the front half. So I'm really excited to like really get into those, because there's stuff that I've never heard of. Like, I have zero experience. My college experience was art school, and I dropped out of art school. So I have zero philosophy experience. My partner is way better versed in philosophy than me. He was a major in philosophy in college. I have no educational background in this. So the way that I'm going to be explaining it will probably have errors, and it will probably not be the most concise, like the best way, but this is the way that I have to explain it to actually understand what it's saying. And a lot of these concepts are like theories. A lot of them are like people that invented theories, and I'm gonna just do a really quick overview, because these beginning parts are more of like laying the groundwork for philosophy. So what does philosophy have to do with cosmic horror? A lot. And I would argue they're the exact same thing. And I'm gonna prove that to you as we get deeper into this iceberg. But for right now, I'm gonna throw some terms at you. Philosophy is basically the study of things that we cannot truly grasp physically, in the broadest sense of the word. So this is questions about your existence, questions about knowledge, questions about when we hit that wall that we cannot understand what happens next, questions about the afterlife, questions about how we should be living, and a lot about God and religion as well. And these ideas and theories were made by people who just sat and thought for a really long time. So a lot of them are things you probably have thought about yourself, but these people put them into words that it's like, wow, I never thought of it that way. And that's like been the most interesting part about researching this so far, is that a lot of these I agree with, some of them I really disagree with, and some of them scare me because I've never thought of the world in this way. So I'm gonna see how much I can fucking break the shit out of my brain and see like how this is gonna disturb me, because it already has disturbed me in a huge way. So cosmic horror, pioneered by Lovecraft, is the idea that things that we don't understand scare us. Like, vaguely, that's the idea of it. So this is like the nature of us versus reality, the limits to our understanding and how that can be horrific for us. This can be existentialism, which is the absurdity of why we are here as human beings, how we exist in a universe that is so cruel and so unforgiving, and how we kind of cope with that. Why are we here? A lot of cosmic horror dives into nihilism, which, in my personal opinion, this iceberg gets more and more nihilistic, which is what I'm looking for, and I think the creator had that kind of in mind. But nihilism is kind of just questioning like the value of human life and if there is any higher power and how likely that is. And I'm not gonna get religious in this video. I'm gonna explore some topics that are maybe a little bit controversial, but I'm gonna say my opinions on them, but it's not my theory, it's just the topic of whatever theory I'm talking about. Another aspect of cosmic horror that's directly linked to philosophy is metaphysics, which is the idea of, is this reality that we're in the only reality, and how do we cope with that, and how do we prove that? Because a lot of these theories are not proven, they are not even provable in any way. It's like things that we can't understand, and that is really, really scary. It's why the clip at the beginning of this video was scary, and it's why this is so interesting to me, because I feel like we are over it with horror media that is things that we understand so well. And that's why I think that slashers aren't really scaring people anymore, and that's why I think long legs didn't scare a lot of people, because we feel like we understand the Satanism devil of it all. We feel like we have a really good grip on that. Okay, we're in tier one. I think there's like 10 or 11, I don't know for sure. Tier one is basically intro to philosophy, so I'm just gonna kind of zoom kind of past it, because you've either heard of these or they're extremely common and they've been talked about a lot before. The first one is Plato's allegory of the cave, and this is like the basis for what this entire iceberg is about, and it's the idea that we are looking at something that's a fake reality. Like, our first reality is not real, and there is like a deeper meaning in reality that we should probably be thinking about. So like, our day-to-day activities are not actually the only thing that exists. There is like an entire background of shit going on in an esoteric way, and Plato's cave is a metaphor that describes this idea. So this thought experiment is that you are in a matrix-like situation where you're in a hole or a cave, right? And you and your entire tribe of people are watching shadows on the wall, and you're arguing about what these shadows are doing. You're seeing these shadows as your only reality, and your entire reality is this shadow world that you're seeing kind of on your TV, which is like a cave. But the idea is, one of the people gets free and turns around and looks at the sun, and once his eyes see the sun, he's like actually blind. And then slowly his eyes adjust to the light, and he sees the trees and the nature, and he sees everything outside of the cave or up outside of the hole. This theory is like, you will find it hard to understand things that are kind of on a deeper level, but you will. And it's also your duty to go back into the cave and try and tell people, hey, I figured this stuff out. There's more to life than this. This is literally me when I watch reality TV on Netflix. Like, I actually know that my brain's rotting. That's like cosmic horror in itself, is me trying to think that I'm thinking of something deeper when I'm watching Love is Blind. I'm addicted to it. I'm addicted to watching it. I love to psychoanalyze people, so sue me. The next topic on the tier is Marcus Aurelius. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. Again, I've taken zero philosophy classes in my entire life. Basically, this dude invented Stoicism, or he popularized it. And this idea of philosophy, I actually agree with the most on a personal level. And it's basically the idea that you should probably just endure life and endure pain without letting it affect you too much, because you should be stronger than what is going on that's hard in life. So he basically said, ignore what others are doing and kind of do whatever you can to make yourself feel stronger, and don't let things get to you too much, and just try your best to be stoic. So it's not indifference per se, it's just like you're stronger than what is harming you. And you should see every opportunity as an opportunity for growth. This like school of thought of stoicism is so fucking large, and there's a cult following behind it, and there's no way that I could possibly describe all of it in like just this little section of a fucking iceberg video. But it is really interesting if you want to like read about it. This is one of the ones that I actually have personal stake in. Like, I really do like it. Basically, he says death is knocking at your door. Don't let life get to you and follow your passions, which is very much agree. Very much agree about that. The next one is the school of life. And this is less of like a person or a theory. And it's more like explaining that philosophy itself is just self-knowledge, and you should kind of be aiming for a little bit of philosophy in your everyday life. And the school of life kind of tries to bridge between academia, philosophy, and like everyday people learning about philosophy, because it is good for your self-awareness. It's good for like for you to think about. So this is like dipping your little pinky toe into the cosmic horrors of philosophy. This first school of life, first tier thing is like, you're dipping your very, very toe into it. And this was articulated by Socrates, which we all know who Socrates is. Not me, but like everyone else seems to. So now I know. But before I did the research, I had no fucking idea. Like I knew his name, I just didn't know who that was. The next one is the first kind of like scary one, like one that's kind of hard to put yourself in the situation. And this is the trolley problem. This is like, we know the trolley problem, yes. But really think about this situation. So imagine you're standing at a railway track and there's a runaway train, and if it keeps on going down its path it's at, it's going to kill 5 people. So it's on track to unalive 5 people. You are able to grab the brake of this to stop it, but it will divert onto another path that would kill only 1 person. So it's kind of the idea of like, would you stop it and be responsible for the death of 1 person? Would you let it go and just ignore it and see it kill 5 people? Or would you, I think that's only 2 options. You can either pull it or you can leave it. Personally, I'm definitely pulling it. Are you actually kidding me? Of course, I'm going to save 4 people if I can. I don't understand why this one's so hard. For people, like, bystander is just as much of a consequence as, like, being actually doing something. Like, I actually firmly believe that. Next one is The Art of War. It's basically like a war manual that says, understand your enemy and understand yourself. So, like, knowing your own strengths and weaknesses is crucial. And yeah, duh. Like, you need to know your own strengths and weaknesses to destroy your enemy. This could also apply to real life. So you can know your own strengths, you know your own weaknesses, you're gonna probably do better at life. This one also said you need to have strategy and tactics, and you need to have leadership, and you need to have logistics. Next one's John Stuart Mill. This is a dude that said utilitarianism is the way. And this is the idea, intent versus actually what happens is important. And also this guy liked women's rights, so actions are right in the proportion as to which they promote happiness or goodness, and they're bad in which the proportion that they take away someone's rights, or they are bad for other people, or they promote pain, or they take away happiness. So this sounds really simple, but it is like a very complicated thing, because you might do something to someone and you inadvertently cause them harm. And your action was bad, even though it wasn't intentional. So this one is Aristotle. It's kind of a huge one. Again, like, never heard of any of this. He thought that happiness is achieved through virtue. So you will be happy if you work on your virtuous traits and you work on your ethics. Do I think this is true? Yes. If you're feeling really, really like anxious, overwhelmed, feel like you're in yourself, the easiest way to improve that is to just go do something for someone else. I wholeheartedly agree with that. Same thing if you're feeling like really, really self-conscious, the best way to feel better is to like think about how you would feel if someone else had those characteristics that you're feeling so bad about yourself for. So this dude is like literally the father of logic. I think we need to bring him back, probably like Jurassic Park style, because there's no more logic. It seems like this is completely out the window, this idea. And that's really sad, but it seems like we're going backwards. There is a theory for that I'm gonna talk about as well. The next one is Augustine of Hippo. Don't love this guy because he literally is the founder of the Roman Catholic Church, and I did not enjoy being in the Roman Catholic Church even a little bit, but he basically did the idea of original sin. So he said that because Adam and Eve like fucked up, we as a people have sin that is we cannot get rid of, and we all have original sin. This idea, the damage that it did to people, I think was absolutely insane. And I think he's responsible for the fact that people are now paying money to get into heaven online on Facebook. This is the dude that started that. I actually am pissed. We are not inherently flawed because of Adam and Eve. We're inherently flawed because we are human beings with selfish desires. And that's just how it is. We're not whatever. The next one's John Locke. And this is the last one in the first tier. So this is the baselines are covered after we finish John Locke. So John Locke is kind of a G. He refuted the idea that kings are better than everyone else, which is so true. He kind of did the opposite of the first guy that I just talked about who said we have original sin. John Locke said that the mind is a blank slate when you're first born. This idea is called tabula rasa. And he said that all knowledge comes from experience. So you're born a blank slate, and then what happens to you and what you experience is kind of what you become. That makes a lot more sense to me than original sin. And I know those two concepts are different. Like, I know it's not the same, like, genre of thought, but I do very much agree with John Locke. He also said that we have natural rights. So that's awesome. Like, we do have natural rights. I love that. So this is like life, liberty, and property. Okay, the first one of the second tier is Bentham, and I'm just gonna talk about utilitarianism again. This guy's the founder of this idea where an action is good or bad based on its outcome, and that's it. It doesn't matter your intention, it doesn't matter anything about that. The next one is the first one that I never ever thought about and is kind of like spooky to think about, Harari Sapiens. This dude's main argument is that we are only as developed as we are as human beings, and we only came to dominate the world because we're the only group that can cooperate flexibly in large numbers. This idea, I think, actually proves itself right when you think about the fact that once you break down community standards and community boundaries with each other and respect with each other, society goes to total shit and like we can't do anything. This guy also did not like the violent treatment of animals by humans, which, yeah, like that's terrible. Epictetus? I'm not pronouncing that right for sure. This is another Stoic Greek philosopher, and he said that you need to find happiness wherever you are. And he was a former slave, so he has a lot of experience in trying to find like happiness where he was and like making life worth living where he was. And he advocated for the acceptance of fate. This is really kind of a dark concept if you think about it. Like, if your life is so incredibly shitty and there's nothing you can do about it, like, do you accept that or do you spend the rest of your life mad at that? This concept makes me nauseous to think about a little bit, because I've been in situations where I really hated where I was, and the thought of like just kind of accepting that fate makes me a little bit scared. And like, what if I didn't have another escape? That's really scary. It's a really dark thing to think about, but is it even life worth living if you're so angry and you can't control what happens? So this is like finding happiness and meaning outside of external factors, and this is like the ultimate boss of Stoicism. If you can find happiness in such a bleak place as this guy, that's crazy. That's like a mental fortitude that I will never even begin to imagine. The next one's Montaigne, and these are getting progressively harder to describe the name of, so just literally leave me alone. I'm really sorry, I'm not perfect. This guy said that pleasure is our greatest motivator. In a really nihilistic viewpoint, you could say that this is so true, because we're literally just monkeys that developed youtube.com and like, do we do everything for pleasure? It makes sense biologically, we might. This dude also advocated for like, not quite hedonism, but like enjoying and having pleasure in your life, like connecting with people, traveling, stuff like that. I agree. Like, that sounds great. So Constant is the next one. This guy tried to unite in the French Revolution, he was trying to unite the middle class. He argued that in the past, like in Rome, they used to value different things that made people happier, like participation in like public life and collective participation just in general, and like more connection with each other. And then like the modern people of the French Revolution era were valuing like property and security and pursuit of happiness. And he thought that we were much, much happier as a people when we were in kind of like the Roman school of thought, and like we were just a little bit more community-based. This is like a good idea, but I don't think it's possible to go back. So it's kind of nihilistic to think about. Would we be happier as in like as we were in the Roman times versus now when we have Amazon.com? Probably not for everyone, but probably. But it's, we can't go back now. The French Revolution, that was too far. Like, they couldn't have gone back. So it's a little bit sad, and I might be totally misinterpreting his like writing. So Descartes is the first one that actually is directly related to an actual horror series, and this guy did the famous I Think Therefore I Am. There is a comic series about like a supercomputer that is called Am. These like creatures and things that think and am that are not human, like that's like the uncanny valley of it all, and like the kind of cosmic horror of it all is like we can't begin to understand what that is, because we can't even begin to understand ourselves. So it just challenges like ourself, our place in the universe, our safety in the universe, and what we cling on to, because our lives are so strange that we have like basically primitive brains, and we're put in these situations where we have to think about all of this cosmic shit going on. So Descartes is like been a major inspiration for a lot of horror stuff, because the idea of a monster is so much this philosophy where I think therefore I am. You could apply self to anything with this philosophy. Anything that thinks is. And that's crazy. So this is like pushing the limits of what we feel comfortable thinking about. Like this is getting to the point where it's a little bit uncomfortable, which is like the cosmic horror sweet spot. The next one's Nietzsche. I never actually read about any of his philosophy, but he was incredibly intense. He famously declared that God is dead. And he said that the Christian values were not helping anybody, basically. He argued that Christian morality had lost its meaning, and this is at a point where Christian morality in history had a huge impact on everyone's life. It still does, but like this was really, really huge, and he thought that this is not helping anyone. It's lost its foundation. Nietzsche's ideal human was someone who rose above traditional morality standards and created their own terms of morality and their own terms of living. And he called this the overman. And this was like the ideal human. So this is like someone who's strong, creative, and has their own power from inside of them, from their own guidelines. And this idea seems really, really obvious. Like, oh, I create my own morality. But I don't think we do. Like, it's very, very hard to do. I don't think I create my own morality. I'm very much in a society where I follow a lot of society's morality. He also thought that traditional values were created by the weak to control the strong. This is actually something that I very much agree with. Growing up in the Roman Catholic Church, my whole life, I do think that it's a very controlling mindset to have a lot of the stuff that they tell you. And that's really controversial, but it's like, I do agree with him, I fear. Hate it or love it, like, this had a profound impact on our modern day philosophy. And I don't think that we would have, like, Satan and non-Satan horror movies and pagan horror movies if it weren't for Nietzsche saying this extremely, extremely crazy offensive stuff way back when, because it probably wouldn't be like an okay thing to say now. I do really think that deep in my heart. Okay, we're going on to the next tier. This is tier 3. And it's gonna get a little bit stinky. So the next one is actually another Nietzsche one, and it's the idea that Nietzsche wrote this book, Will to Power. The book was supposed to be written by his sister after Nietzsche died, but there's a conspiracy theory that he actually wrote it. This book includes stuff like self-overcoming, so like our job is not to overcome other people, but to overcome ourselves. And that's how we grow, is to overcome our own limitations, not like comparing it to other people's. This book also praised creativity and like creating stuff and said that that was power. And like that was one of the ultimate things that we can do as people. I agree. And that's why AI makes me so upset. Again, he said that traditional morality is a tool that is like created by the weak to control the strong. And he wanted people to create their own new values. He thought that that was like the most powerful thing you could do. The next one I'm going to talk about is actually a collection of paradoxes called Zeno's Paradoxes. These ones were the first ones that kind of made me think about things in a way that made me a little bit unsettled. Imagine an arrow flying in midair, and the idea is that if you froze time for a single second, the arrow's not moving, so it never was moving. Don't like that. Like, it makes me like really upset. These ideas though are mostly like mathematical debates. So the first one, I'm not quite understanding that well. The arrow one, I do understand. And that does make me a bit uncomfortable. Like, motion doesn't exist. It makes me feel like my cells are gonna fly out. Like, I actually like, okay, what does exist? If you froze it for a second and it wasn't moving, was it ever moving? It's based on our perception. Our perception's not real. That's kind of where the cosmic horror of it all comes in. And I have a weird theory that a lot of the uncanny ghost movements that we get from a lot of horror movies, especially Japanese horror, directly takes from this idea that the traditional way that the physical world works is not how we think it works. And that shakes the foundation of everything we've ever done. Just like at the beginning when they see the earth is flat, it's like, nothing they have done makes any sense after they have this knowledge and this information. And the idea that like something could just happen to shatter your entire worldview is something that is way scarier than seeing a ghost or getting chased, because it would shatter your worldview if something happened like that you can't explain in any physical way. Hate it so much. It's so scary to me. Okay, next one is a state of nature. These states of nature are like what some philosophers think is the way that humans are without any interference. So he thinks that without any government interference, we are peaceful as people and we're living simple lives, like almost like animals in a pasture, and that we have a natural sense for compassion and it would be pretty nice, it would be peaceful. But he believed that when we started forming societies and making governments and rules, that's when it took a turn for the worse, and these new rules created inequality and unhappiness. So our original state of nature is peaceful and rules ruined it. Our state of nature was so peaceful and simple, but it was perfect in its own way. And did we make it imperfect by creating rules? And is that the interference that made it bad? Epicurus was the guy that loved to enjoy life. He believed in a simple, pleasure-filled life. So enjoying the small pleasures of life was the meaning of life itself. And the best life was one without pain or worry. He also thought to avoid unnecessary worry and fears, we should understand the world around us. Think less like selfish hedonism indulgence and more like understanding and contentment and finding simple joys and pleasures. While I do agree with some of this, I do think that we need some kind of problem in our life, because if we don't, we will make one up in our head. And that might not be everyone, but that's definitely my experience. And I try to focus on the good parts of life, but if I only did that, I think that I fear I would go, like, it would be just delusional. Like, I just feel like that's borderline going on delusion. But that's why it's philosophy, because it's, like, great to argue about. Next one is Marx. I don't think I could talk about him on YouTube, so I'm not going to, but you know who that is and you know what his philosophies are. So Beyond Good and Evil is a work by Nietzsche again, and this reiterated a lot of the stuff I talked about with Nietzsche before, but the new thing with this piece of work is that our understanding of the world is shaped by our perceptions and values. So the world looks different to every single person based on their values and based on the way they see the world and based on their experiences, which I think is very true to an extent, and I think it kind of depends on how rigid those perceptions are. But Nietzsche was trying to critique where we get this knowledge and perception from in the first place. And this idea kind of goes into other ideas that I'm going to talk about in a bit, which dismantle the entire idea of anything that you learn, which I don't like that, because the way that I feel better in the world is knowing that there are scientists and people that I learn from that set a baseline of what I say I think is normal and what I think is the right thing to do. So don't like that, to think about that, because what am I going to do about it? Like, if none of the knowledge I get is real knowledge, like, what am I supposed to fucking do? So Camus' Sisyphus is basically Albert Camus' ideas about Sisyphus, the guy who rolls the boulder up a hill for eternity in, I think it's the Greek version of hell. So that's his punishment. He's to roll the boulder up and it rolls back down and he has to keep doing it. So Camus saw Sisyphus as a metaphor for, like, the indomitable human spirit, and, like, that he found meaning in rolling this boulder up and down. He is a metaphor for the human condition, which is we're trapped in a meaningless, endless cycle. We as humans are trapped in a repetitive, meaningless cycle. And the fact that Sisyphus is rolling this boulder up the hill knowing it will come back down is like a metaphor for our entire existence. Conscious defiance of the absurdity that's rolling the boulder up the hill, we find meaning as people. Which is true in a way, because we are all gonna die and we know that, but we do stuff even though, you know, like, we know what the end is gonna be like and we keep rolling the boulder up the hill. And the hero isn't the one who finds a way to escape the cycle, the hero is the one that continues to push the boulder with defiance. While Sisyphus's task doesn't do anything, it's his attitude that is the most important part. Socrates' irony is, I don't know if you've seen the YouTube channel, Channel 5, Andrew Callahan, I think is his name, that does the interviews. He does this a lot, and this is the idea that you should play dumb to make someone else look dumb and, like, show the actual extent to their intelligence or their lack of intelligence. This is in Channel 5 a lot, because he will interview people that are extremely dumb and, like, objectively, like, they are dumb. Like, a lot of, like, it's crazy. It's really entertaining, it's really funny, but a lot of these people have ideas that they don't even understand why they feel that way. So he'll just ask them kind of dumb questions. You can see the gears turning in their head, like, oh, that actually doesn't make sense that I think like that, but they're never gonna admit that. But it's, like, kind of a fun way to interact with someone who, you know, doesn't actually believe what they say they believe. So, like, by asking a lot of silly questions, you can kind of set someone up for looking really dumb. And that's mean, but it sometimes must be done. It's sometimes the only way. Peter Singer, this is, I'm just gonna kind of breeze by because nothing really new. He liked utilitarianism and he advocated for animal rights, because obviously when you're mean to an animal, it has a direct bad impact. And, like, in utilitarianism, your actions, morality is determined by its outcome. Okay, the last one on this tier, and I just took a little break because it's, look at how cute my wallpaper is. It's Donnie Darko. The last one on this tier is basically just the idea that the simplest explanation is probably right, or it's usually just the best explanation. So, like, if you find a vase broken on your floor, you can think that it's either a ghost or it's your cat, and it's probably your cat. That's the whole philosophy. This could get dark and scary if you were thinking about it in the way that Sometimes the simplest explanation is the worst one, and it's like the most obvious and simplest explanation is the scariest explanation. Like if someone did something and you have a feeling that they did something, that can get into like the cosmic horror territory of it all. I really, really wanted to get the next level, like below this one, done in this video, but it's getting incredibly late and also my camera's dying. So I really wanted to get into, like, for example, the next one has to do with a philosophy resembling the Matrix movies. I think it's really interesting. I'm gonna have to do it in the next video. I'm gonna try and maybe release it in the same week just because I want to get to the end of it. I want to get to the bottom tiers. I want to really get into those. So I'm excited to make that one. If you watched to the end, I hope it was interesting so far. It will get scarier, but I would love to hear your thoughts on the cosmic horror of our fucking life and the ways in which cosmic horror scares you in horror. My favorite cosmic horror has got to be, I remember when I watched Midsommar for the first time, I literally felt like there was no escape from that situation. My cat's going totally fucking crazy. I felt like there was no escape from that situation in a way that I never really felt before when I was watching a horror movie. And that is a type of cosmic horror to me, to just be like totally hopeless in a situation where there is no escape. That's worse to me than getting chased by like a chainsaw murderer. But that's me. That's just me. And I would love to hear what you think. So if you watched to the end, thank you so much. I love to make videos, so I love to post. Okay, have a wonderful night or a wonderful day. Peace.